Asian Paints grew, of course, volume growth 10% in the fourth quarter. Marico did 8%, HUL did 7%, Britannia did 7%. But then you have Dabur at 4%, Pidilite 2.5%, Godrej Consumer 1%. And I'm not even getting into the auto majors who have got contracting sales numbers. Joining me to discuss the consumption scenario, Saugata Gupta, Managing Director and CEO of Marico. Vinita Bali, former Managing Director and CEO of Britannia Industries, a long-time consumer expert. And with me in the studio is quite clearly the consumer economy veteran, Rama Bijapurkar. Thank you, Rama, Vinita and Saugata. Well, let me start with the practitioner who has actually the boots on the ground. Saugata, you did not report a very bad quarter at all, 8% volume growth. But zoom out from your company and into the economy itself. Are you witnessing something which is definitely worrisome, either in the rural or in the urban demand space?
So I think if you look at the complete year, yes, it started off much better. The quarter one obviously had a lower base of the previous year, which was the GST transition. Having said that, I think what we witnessed is rural, which was outpacing urban for at least 2-3 quarters. We had a slowdown starting sometime in February and March. At the same time, there are some changes happening in urban, where I think wholesale as a channel, which is little shrinking post GST. So therefore, companies with direct rural distribution and innovation, premiumization and the top end is likely to succeed over the long term.
Okay. Well, I'll just scratch the rural.
I would say that it is a little temporary. Yeah.
Oh, that was going to be my next question. Have you seen this kind of rural distress before? I'm asking you because, you know, we've had a series of farmer marches to Delhi. The rural distress talk is far more widespread and consistent over the last couple of years than I have seen in my journalism career. So is this just looking like temporary, one of those slowdowns, cyclical, or is this worse?
So if I look at it, I think there is a marginal slowdown. There are some liquidity concerns in the channel. But as I said, I think sometimes we tend to get over-optimistic and over-pessimistic. So I would say, yes, we will wait and watch. Let's see how this year pans out. In my opinion, I think it is a little bit temporary as opposed to a significant long-term issue. And I'm sure as the post-elections, one of the things about the new government will be to handle it. And some steps had already been taken in the last few quarters.
Okay. Rama, let me come to you. Before we dig into causes, what are you observing? I mean, you sit on boards of several companies. You even observe them from the outside. Is this a slowdown, a passing slowdown, a serious slowdown?
It's not as good as everyone would like it to be, and it's not as bad as everybody's making it out to be. I mean, there's some notional number that your markets, as I've said often on your show, is very different from my markets.
Yes.
And I think it's some notional number. So for the same voices that you have actually produced, Hindustan Lever said we've delivered a strong performance this quarter despite moderation. Nestle said market momentum remains strong, volumes are tracking as expected. Dabur says we'll continue to invest. You're not hearing gloom and doom from Saugata.
No.
So I think the first point is that there are winners and there are losers. There are some who steadily hold the course and there are some who don't. I think in fact we've had good quality growth. I think that's the general sentiment of people in the business. It's not on the back of cost inflation led price increases. No one's taken three price increases in the same year to get a revenue number. It's not on the back of imprudent credit. It's in fact less formal, more informal credit has actually decreased. It's not on the back of B1, G2F marketing, buy one, get two free. And it's across the price spectrum. It's not on the back of, of a stimulus like a pay commission stimulus and so on. So I think the growth we're seeing is good core growth and there is a very good base from where to go on, up.
Okay.
Is there trouble? Of course there's trouble. Are the farmers, if you look at the occupation structures of India, I mean, they're either petty traders and shopkeepers or they're labor, there's not much demand for labor, or they're in agriculture. And I think all sectors are hurting. But I would agree with Chugato.
That it is a passing discomfort and not anything, seriously worrisome.
Yeah, we should stop being bullish and bearish about consumption like we are about the stock markets.
No, normally when a political class responds with an income transfer, we have not seen this kind of one party saying we have to transfer 2,000 rupees to every family with 1 acre. They are responding to a real pain and a counter, which could be, of course, competitive, speaking about an even more amount of money. So what we are trying to guess is there a genuine fall in demand at lower levels? Let me get Vinita's view as well on that. Vinita, as an observer and as a former practitioner, how are you looking at the current talk of slowdown? In autos and two-wheelers, it is severe. It's contractionary. In FMCG, we see it in bits and pieces. I mean, Pidilite was a giant which year after year gave us, double-digit growth. This time, 2.5%. And what is Saugato telling us? That February and March were bad suddenly. So, your thoughts?
So, Lata, it's quite evident that there has been a slowdown in the last quarter. And I think we have to be fairly circumspect when we look at these numbers. To some extent, this should not have come as the kind of surprise that it did, because the indications were already there. We've talked a lot about rural wages and the rural economy. Well, the thing is that rural wages have actually contracted in the last year. There was, just to put some facts on the table, in the April 2018 report published by RBI, they broke down rural incomes from 2002 to 2007, which was a nominal increase of about 4 to 5%.
Yes.
2008 to 2013, prompted by Narega, etc., was double digit in the range of 13 to 14%. 2014 onwards, there has been a contraction. So it comes as no surprise that rural wages are down. MSPs in the last five years have been lower than they have ever been before. So the rural economy is stressed. I think the second fact is that if we were to look at the MSMEs, which account for about 45% of total manufacturing, as a result of both demonetization and GST, the MSME sector is hurting. They employ about 120 million people, 65 million MSMEs. So there has been a contraction there. So whether one looks at individual consumption, or you look at the pace of government spending, or you look at the rate of gross capital formation or exports, the fact is that all three of these have actually been stressed in the last quarter and certainly the quarter before that. And we are seeing that impact. Now, is it all doom and gloom? The answer is no. As Rama already alluded to it, and as did Saugata, I think we have to really say, okay, what are some of the structural and systemic things that have to happen to provide that stimulus, whether it is further decrease in interest rates or whatever. But I think those are the four key areas to look at.
Okay. Well, actually, you've spoken like an economist, enlisting some of the big macros, rural wages, fall in agricultural prices, which means the farmer has less purchasing power, and of course, gross fixed capital formation. In fact, net asset creation. We did a previous election exchange on that, and that showed that corporate India has created far less net assets in the last 5 years than it did in previous bunches of 5 years. Quite clearly, so much of their assets is blocked in NPA and they're not creating. So that's also meant less jobs. Saugato, is there a shift in pattern? There are fewer, as incomes grow, you spend less on food, and that may explain part of the rural surplus and fall in food prices. That's one explanation, that agri surplus is because every year agriculture can grow at 3%, but your food needs of the population and the entire population itself is not growing at the same pace. They're buying something else. So is there a structural shift in rural demand itself? Are more rural areas becoming semi-urban?
I would think that there are issues which are there on supply chain inefficiencies, on productivity in agriculture as opposed to food consumption. If you look at our overall urban, there is enough opportunities for people moving from unbranded to branded, looking at better quality. So I think it's the issue of the getting the inefficiencies on the system, the middlemen and other things. I don't think there is enough opportunities to upgrade in food, moving from basic crops to cash crops and other, you know, other items. And there is enough opportunities in demand internally or as exports. But there has to be a structural change in terms of improving productivity, technology, and the supply chain efficiencies, which can lead to, you know, better, you know, returns for the farmers. And I don't think it is a question of demand.
Okay. I take your point. There are a lot of efficiencies that can create. Welcome back to our special show, Election Exchange, It's the Economy. In the last edition of Election Exchange, It's the Economy, we are discussing the consumer. A bunch of FMCG majors have posted lower volume growth than historically we have seen from them, the likes of Pidilite or Dabur in particular. Likewise, the slightly higher range consumption goods, two-wheelers and auto majors, have posted contraction in their sales. And quite separately, I wanted to raise another issue, which today an economist is pointing out, that India in the months of March and more so in April is consuming even less fuel products, as yesterday's trade data indicated, which means the economy is not chugging on, that it wants more energy products. That's a bit worrying. I've been speaking with Rama Bijapurkar, the consumption economy expert, Vinita Bali, formerly of Britannia, and Shaugata Gupta, the head of Marico. Well, Rama, from the experience that you are, that you have from various companies, what is your sense? Is this is one good monsoon enough to turn the FMCG economy?
You know, I think there is no FMCG economy. Okay, today I think people, if your FS have gone up, it will come at the cost of something else. So you are seeing massive cross-category competition, and I think if you look at the consumer as a whole, electronics and phones are going to actually come out of, and soaps and other such stuff. I mean, that's the way it's going to be.
Okay. So think you're saying this is a satiated demand, and that's why...
I'm not saying that. I'm saying that talking about FMCG demand itself, doesn't really make sense in itself. Okay. If you're looking at total consumption, I'm saying yes, things are bad. The bottom 20% of India has always been seriously poor. To your other question, they are dissavers. They've always been subsidized. Agriculture has always not been profitable because of the bulk of farmers.
Are the other quintiles seeing more distress? Yes, the bottom quintile
are the other quintiles. Okay, so the top 20% has enough money. It has enough surplus. As I've said often, if they're not buying cars, it's exactly like corporate India does have. You know, there are more rating upgrades than there are downgrades, I'm told. So they do have money. They're just not investing. These people do have money, they're not spending. Obviously, there is the long-term stuff of whether they will spend on electric cars or whether they will spend on Uber. But okay, if I take it all as transportation, I'm saying that they have money.
It's a technology disruption, not an economy issue.
They have money. They may not have growth as much as they possibly can, but they have enough money to buy cars.
What about the second, third quintiles?
The second, third, and fourth quintiles are always just about 5 to 6% surplus. If you have inflation, they get wiped out. If you have lower growth and income, they just about balance. If you look at the sentiment surveys also of the RBI, I mean, I think people are saying, yeah, I don't think I want to spend as much because I'm waiting and watching. I think that's what the surveys actually say. So the news for you is that the top 20% are the ones who make or break it. The balance for certain companies, absolutely true. The bottom 20% has been a dissaver, and I think they do qualify for subsidies of all kinds. So today, everybody is in sort of pause mode. It's doing worse. The only way incomes can increase is if there is more economic activity or if government gives you money. Okay. Both of them have not happened in recent times as much as possible.
Okay. Well, so sentiment clearly is not driving consumption. That's the hurdle to consumption. Vinita, what has been your experience? You said that you've seen rural areas in recent times show more distress.
Yeah, I think, you know, as we've said, people will spend money, A, if they have money to spend, and B, if they feel good about themselves, about the economy and so on. And I think what we are also seeing is that wherever people can perhaps postpone a decision, they are postponing. We're not seeing it as much as low unit price, high velocity products, which is what we were talking about earlier. And also, I think it is a question of, you know, what happens and how we interpret it is a question both of historical performance as well as expectation. Now, a 7-8% volume growth traditionally, or, you know, in typically in India, and if you add to that a 5-6% inflation, actually created the double-digit revenue growths that we saw for a long time. Now, a 7-8% growth in volume also to me says that there are two things that are happening. One is per capita consumption is certainly going up, and we are also bringing in new users, because, you know, that's how you would explain a volume growth of 7-8%. Pricing is an issue. I think we are seeing, you know, low inflation, and that's part of the reason why the rural economy is so depressed, because your food inflation and my food inflation is the farmer's income. So I think there are many things that are happening simultaneously. At the end of the day, if consumption is to be boosted, and, you know, our growth for a long time has really been consumption-led growth, and it should be, because in most categories, you know, we are both under-penetrated and under-marketed too, which is reflected in our low per capita consumptions across most categories. So I think two things have to happen. One is, you know, consumers have to feel good, and they will feel good if we are creating jobs, if they have more money to spend. And the second is the boost or the stimulus that gets provided in an economy as a result of greater and greater government spending. And we've seen that, you know, that has also in the recent past actually come down. So I think there is a whole confluence of factors, and they have to be addressed both structurally, systemically, as well as, you know, from the point of view of short-term stimuli for growth.
Exactly. Which brings my last question to you. You know, for the first time we have seen many political parties actually promising income transfers. The BJP has already done the first tranche of 2,000 rupees for families with less than 1 acre land. Do you think that's the way to go? First, the moral question, Congress is promising even more. And secondly, do these typically make a difference?
You know, Lata, we've seen this before under different names. You know, what was Narega? Narega also promised, you know, 100 days of employment and so on. We are finding different ways of putting more money into the hands of the rural poor, because we're not able to either make agriculture a viable option for them, which I actually think we should. You know, we are still a country where 180 million people sleep hungry every night. So do we need to increase our ag productivity? The answer is absolutely yes. Do we need to reduce the wastages in the supply chain? The answer is absolutely yes. But coming back to your specific question, by putting more money in the hands of these people, the expectation or the hope is that they will spend. Now, this is actually treating the symptom. It is not addressing the cause. The cause will only be addressed if, on a recurring basis, we provide enough opportunities either in the rural areas themselves or to support the rural migration to urban areas for these people to actually improve their well-being and earn more money. So unless there is real economic activity, unless there is real economic wealth being produced, we can keep giving a lot of these, and certainly in the short term, it will make a difference. I mean, look at what has happened with Narega. You know, it started, you know, it's still continuing in some form or manner. Over and above that, we're doing this. Then we're saying we'll write off your farm loans. We are not addressing the cause, which is we have to increase agricultural productivity, we have to give higher MSPs, we have to put more money in the hands of these people, and we have to make sure that the wealth that is created is distributed.
Yeah, I take your point entirely. You know, we did have one edition on jobs, and that threw up some rather despondent data, despairing data on the lack of job creation. But you're taking it a point further. It's not just job creation. They have to be productive. We have to increase productivity. That's, of course, the longer term goal, I would assume. But Saugata, last word from you. First, how much of a slowdown, you know, how long do you think this slowdown can be? How much does it smell? And what difference do income transfers make? Are they the recipe for this kind of rural distress?
I think income transfer, which is a direct benefit transfer, which has zero leakage, is very good. I think that is one of the things which is very critical, because it has to drive short-term consumption. But having said that, I think long-term, in terms of creating employment opportunities and driving agricultural productivity and returns, are, I think it's something which the government needs to look into. Subsidies is a very short-term solution, because subsidies are not the root.
Yes.
But I think we need some kind of an injection. And I believe that I think they are cognizant of what needs to be done. And we have to wait and watch. I think it's not all gloomy. And I believe this will be a decent year, as long as, you know, these things get right.
Okay. Well, the other question to you was, do you think, say, second half, September onwards, looks better to you? Or does it look like a slightly longer drawn slowdown?
See, if the economic growth is good, food inflation is under control, and monsoon is decent, and there is some fillip in terms of agricultural productivity, and I think they'll, and capital investment starts. So, and it's not that everything will be a hockey stick kind of a change. I think it will be decent. It will take time to recover, but I don't think it's going to be a spiral downwards, as far as I am concerned, because as far as this sector is concerned, I think there will be a certain base level growth.
Okay, so it's not a spiral down. That's one takeaway. And as a consumer of agricultural raw material, you obviously don't want food inflation. Vinita Bali is looking at the consumer, and she would like a little bit of food inflation. But I think the reality, as the numbers, the wholesale price numbers that came yesterday and the consumer price number that came a little earlier, are indicating that food prices are actually recovering. Maybe it's a low base. Rama, last word to you. Does it look like we are in for consumption pickup, or is this a longer drawn slowdown?
Be happy if you, the forthcoming year, if we do 10% and do it consistently and do good quality growth, that's fine. If
you can, we do it.
This, I think I'm saying, be prepared that that's what it will be.
Okay.
It will be status quo. But having said that, there will, if you know, agriculture is acts of God and acts of government, okay? I don't think we're going to have acts of government coming in by the time the whole machinery picks up. It's going to take time. So let's be realistic. If acts of God do happen, and if finally we start investing, because you will only create employment opportunities if you have investments. So I think India Inc. has the money to invest. I mean, this capacity stuff is there. Capacity utilization, no utilization is, again, a decision you make depending on how much you can actually milk the demand, right?
Yes.
So when we start kickstarting that, when jobs, if you have more houses being built, all of India earns from labor, a lot of it. So I think that's okay. And the, you know, as far as the basic income, etc., is concerned, good for HUL. Maruti still has to find its way. Good for Jio. The airline industry still has to figure out what to do. So I think let's understand that it is a hydra-headed monster, and we have to look at all the pieces coming together.
All right. Rama, Vinita and Saugato, thank you very much for adding so much color, nuance and numbers to our understanding of the consumption space. I think the most important point that Saugato is telling us is this is not a spiral down. So we don't have to despair so much. Vinita is bringing a little more of the consumer angle, saying that the rural distress is more than she has seen in previous times, and therefore that is a bit of worry. Perhaps the income transfers are going to ameliorate, but finally much will depend on people investing. Government will not be yet ready to invest, especially if it is going to spend more of its money in income transfer. So it may not be a job creating next few months or next 1 year that we are going to see. Corporate India as well is at the moment not speaking about investments, and the global demand is weak, which also means we are not going to see some bit of investments coming from India to service global demand as well. So investment is not picking up just yet. Government will only do income transfers initially rather than investment. We do hope a good monsoon at least will ameliorate the current distress in India's farmland. So consumption not spiraling down, but not looking like a great year just yet. Thank you very much for watching this special edition of It's the Economy.